Using deoxyribonucleic acid, or DNA, for digital data storage is perhaps the most intriguing digital biology idea that I've come across in a while. It sounds crazy, but it can work. In 2020, San Francisco-based Twist Biosciences collaborated with Netflix to encode the first episode of a recent TV show, Biohackers, into synthetic DNA. One 2020 study probed the theoretical storage limits and postulated a density of 17 exabytes per gram of DNA. And that DNA is sturdy. The molecules can last many years. We even mined it to bring back the dinosaurs. So the pitch is that we turn DNA into a super long-term, write-once, never-read form of cold storage. And I love stuff like this. In this video, we explore a strange but feasible storage technology. Soon after DNA's discovery in the early 1950s, people noticed how it carried a lot of data in a very small package, and they thought about ways to take advantage of it. Richard Feynman mentioned the idea in his famous talk, "There's Always Plenty of Room at the Bottom," and Norbert Wiener also mentioned the future possibility of data storage using quote-unquote genetic memories in a 1964 interview with the U.S. News and Report. A bit later, a Soviet physicist named Mikhail Neyman talked about miniaturizing electronics. This field led him to the idea of synthetic DNA and RNA molecules for data storage. Interesting ideas from great thinkers, but considering just how few tools were then available for making and sequencing DNA, it all remained idle speculation. DNA is a long molecule containing the data necessary for life functions. It is made up of a pair of strands that coil around each other, connected in the famous double helix structure. Between the strands, we have a string of nucleotides, each containing a base. Famously, there are four big bases, and they all belong to us: adenine, guanine, cytosine, and thymine. The strands are complementary. Every base in the sequence has a complementary base bonded to it. A is always bonded with T, and C is always bonded with G. This structure makes double-stranded DNA more resilient than single-stranded DNA. It also contributes to replication, which we will talk about later. Having four bases allows us to, in theory, store two bits per base, like for example, A is equal to 00, G is equal to 01, and what have you. But in practice, most data storage implementations as of today encode one bit per base for better data redundancy in case of errors, a common concern. As modern DNA technologies developed, the idea of using DNA for storing data resurfaced. Richard Dawkins mentioned it in his 1986 book, The Blind Watchmaker, but the concept really caught people's attention in the bioart sphere. In 1996, Joe Davis, a research affiliate at MIT and Harvard Medical School, collaborated with molecular biologist Dana Boyd on a work of bioart he called Microvenus. With Microvenus, Davis encoded a binary representation of a symbolic icon into a sequence of DNA. This was in turn inserted into an E. coli bacteria. He saw this use of a bacteria as a means to communicate with aliens, since DNA inside a bacterium can persist in the harsh environments of space longer than any magnetic tape or golden disk. Then in 1999, Nature published a very interesting paper from Vivian Rivesca of Stanford and Carter Bancroft of Stony Brook. Here they used DNA to encode and shrink a secret message into a small concealable microdot, like those used by spies. It was the first use of DNA-based storage by itself, without the intention to insert the strand into a living thing. And I think that is an important point to emphasize. The technology is using DNA as a mere tool to store data, not to modify living creations, and there are steps taken to avoid unwanted crossover. Things took a major step forward in the early 2010s with two major papers, the first in 2012 from a team led by George Church at Harvard Medical School, and the second in 2013 from a team led by Nick Goldman at the European Bioinformatics Institute. The two teams encoded a significant amount of data, 700 kilobytes and 5 megabytes, into DNA. Just as importantly, they were largely able to pull the encoded data back out of the DNA. In the 10 plus years since, teams have been storing increasingly larger amounts of data in different formats and using novel ways. Like in 2017, a team at Harvard Medical School encoded images in a digital movie into the genomes of living bacteria using CRISPR. In living creatures, DNA encodes for proteins that help carry out the function of life, whatever that may be. DNA information is first transcribed to messenger RNA, and after that the messenger RNA is used for creating proteins. But since most DNA data implementations are not interested in making proteins, we change the flow. First of all, we need to encode the digital data we want to store. In other words, we use an algorithm or codec to map a string of bits to a DNA sequence. There are some standards out there for this. For example, the JPEG committee is working on a draft for standards for storage and archival in DNA. These codecs are fun. Some things they do you expect, like error correction. Errors like the unintentional addition or removal of some nucleotide might help creatures evolve into superior forms. But having the data inside your storage application evolve into something nonsensical is unwanted, so error correction is necessary. Most seem to turn to solutions in the digital world. One well-known one is the Reed-Solomon correction system used today for CDs and other media. You break the data into parts and then store them alongside what are called parity parts for redundancy. If a data part cannot be found, we can use the parity parts and a polynomial function to try and reconstitute the information. In addition to that, there are a few DNA-specific things you might not expect. For example, you cannot use the G and C bases too often. Experiences with PCR have found that a high proportion of GC bases, like 60% or more, tend to cause molecular instability. Moreover, sequences with too many repetitions of a single base are more difficult to produce or read, so the codec needs to avoid that too. And we need to avoid sequences with possible biological implications, like protein production, just in case the DNA might meet some biological machinery, like a bacterium or virus. After encoding the data, we now need to write it to the DNA. This means making DNA, a step called synthesis. DNA synthesis is seen as a major bottleneck in the technology's overall development. Out in the wild, a dividing cell will replicate its DNA strand by first unzipping and splitting into two. Then each of the halves is used as a template so that each new cell gets a new DNA copy. In the 1980s, humanity developed the Nobel-winning polymerase chain reaction. It takes a single DNA template and amplifies it to huge numbers, usually for diagnostic purposes, like if we are looking for a particular DNA. The issue with both methods is that they require a template, making them unsuitable for DNA data storage, where we want to assemble nucleotides in arbitrary sequences. This subcategory of DNA synthesis is called gene synthesis, or sometimes DNA printing. It refers to the use of chemicals or enzymes to put together short sequences of nucleotides called oligonucleotides. The leading technology for doing this is phosphoramidite synthesis, first invented at the University of Colorado back in the 1980s. It uses a cycle to build up an oligonucleotide, nucleotide by nucleotide. It starts with us anchoring a chain to something solid, usually a silicon substrate, and then adding nucleotides to the chain with a four-step cycle. The cycle will include blocking steps to prevent erroneous additions, taking about 4 to 6 minutes to add a single base. Despite being the gold standard when it comes to accuracy and yield, phosphoramidite synthesis has several issues relating to waste, cost, and errors. Waste because you use a lot of chemical solvents throughout the cycle, and that waste adds more cost to a process that is already pretty labor-intensive. Custom gene synthesis is not cheap. Today, it is about 10 to 30 cents per base, so a 3,000 base long gene will cost $300 to $1,000. Considering that there are 8.8 trillion bits in a terabyte, encoding that much data into DNA would cost anywhere from $800 million to $2.6 billion. To compare, magnetic tape costs about $16 per terabyte. One more significant issue are the errors. If we try to extend the oligonucleotide too much, maybe 300 nucleotides or so, then it will suffer serious errors. The usual way around this is to make many small bits. For example, the Church and Goldman teams used chemical synthesis to make over 150,000 short strings, each of about 117 bases. Silicon-based microarrays like those from Twist Biosciences in South San Francisco can help aid in this by making many different oligonucleotides in parallel. There is also the enzymatic synthesis method. It uses enzymes from nature, just like how cells use DNA polymerase enzymes to replicate. A promising method uses the cool but poorly understood terminal deoxynucleotidyl transferase. to make an oligonucleotide from scratch without a template. This is definitely cutting-edge stuff. After the data is encoded to the DNA, we need to store it in such a way to preserve it. This is not yet a solved problem. Like I mentioned, DNA is quite sturdy, but only in the right conditions. The strand should not be too long. It needs to be kept away from destabilizing heat or UV radiation. So most labs store DNA in freezing temperatures below zero, but room temperature can work if you remove the water. You can also absorb it into something like filter paper or silk, which stabilizes the DNA and prevents it from falling apart. You can also do encapsulation, essentially inserting the DNA strand into a capsule of silica, iron oxide, or something else inorganic. Encapsulation allows more of the DNA to survive difficult conditions, high temperatures, dryness, age, what have you, but at the cost of density and accessibility. We can also store the data inside a living creature, like how they did with the E. coli bacteria in that microvenous art piece. On one hand, you can leverage the organism's own desire to reproduce and survive to persist the data over time. Like, we can insert the DNA into the extremophile bacteria Deinococcus radiodurans, one of the most radiation-resistant organisms known to man, and then send that sucker into space. On the other hand, we again have to deal with the whole error thing. Bacterium DNA suffers errors during replication, and that needs to be suppressed. How to do this remains a bit speculative, not to mention the ick factor associated with it. So we have this pool of DNA, and now we want to access some of the stored data. Ideally, we do not want to have to go through all the data in the pool in order to find the item we want, which would require us to sequence the entire pool at very high cost. In other words, we want random access. Probably the simplest way to achieve this would be with an addressing system. You have these physically separated subpools of DNA addressed such that someone can easily get to it. The problem with this physical separation is that it prevents us from making the data storage as dense as we might want. So in 2015, a new, more efficient system was proposed. It uses PCR's ability to target and amplify certain DNA segments. So we use one or multiple PCR runs to amplify a short specific strand of DNA, which would be attached to a single file called a primer, out of a pool. A few other systems have been proposed. One that I like uses chemicals and magnetic beads to separate out specific lengths of DNA, again representing files. To actually read the randomly accessed data, we use existing DNA sequencing tools. Compared to synthesis, sequencing is far cheaper, less than 2% of the total cost of a read-write cycle. The history behind DNA sequencing is quite interesting, and I discussed it in another video about Illumina, but here is the short version. There are three widely used types of sequencing. First, we have Sanger sequencing, which first entered the market in 1977. It remains a gold standard in reading long sequences, but tends to be more expensive in part because it is rather slow. So Illumina introduced sequencing by synthesis, a new generation of sequencing. This amplifies a shorter sequence of DNA, and when we then trigger DNA synthesis using a chemical adding fluorescent-tagged nucleotides, we then read the light generated by the nucleotides as they get added on during DNA synthesis in order to see the sequence. Sequencing by synthesis is very good for short reads. It works fast and has a relatively low error rate, about 0.5% error rate for each nucleotide. The downside is that you can generally read about 400 nucleotides at one time, so Illumina machines will break down a longer sequence into overlapping fragments, sequence those, and then put them together again. These new sequencing methods have massively reduced sequencing's cost and cycle time. It would have taken 100 years to sequence a person's genome using Sanger sequencing, but these tools can do it in a day for about $20 to $50 per billion bases, with the price depending on the levels of accuracy, 88% to about 99.9%. Third, we have seen what we call nanopore sequencing technologies. First commercialized by Oxford Nanopore, nanopore sequencing runs strands of DNA over tiny pores in a membrane. When that happens, the DNA interrupts the flow of ions moving from one pore to another. The changes in the current can be interpreted to find out what nucleotides are in the strand. Nanopore technologies are better for longer reads, tens of thousands of, or even millions of bases at a time. However, that is counterbalanced with a higher error rate, about 10% per nucleotide. Nevertheless, both these newer sequencing technologies work quite well and make reading DNA data fairly economical. This long, complicated process, for all its challenges, has issues that should be dealt with before any implementation becomes commercial. A topic that I have ignored throughout this entire video is security. DNA size and portability makes it easy to steal. Bad actors can even insert false data into the sequences using something like CRISPR. There are also concerns about automating the whole process and making it speedier and more portable. A hard disk drive is so successful because the whole thing fits into a tiny space. We don't need to automate to that level. Hoses, valves, and pipettes will always be needed for gene stuff. However, we shouldn't need a whole lab to pull some files off a hard disk drive. Perhaps this can be where a microfluidic lab on a chip tool can be helpful. The technology and flow to making DNA storage work is around. It can be done. And I do want to call out the work of the DNA Data Storage Alliance, which has quietly been making progress on the idea with the aid of universities and a few partners. Teams seem to be consistently making new breakthroughs in the topic. But right now, it is not economically viable, especially compared to the continually falling costs of tape and hard disk drives. There remains serious techno-economic challenges throughout the entire read-write cycle, but particularly when synthesizing long strings of DNA. It seems that DNA storage's most economical use case is as some form of ultra-cold storage, as in not just a few years, more like decades or even hundreds of years of storage. I don't see this being attached to your desktop computer anytime soon. But DNA's advantages in data density and long-term persistence are undeniable, and considering its importance to biology, the surrounding DNA technology will always be around. I just wonder if the commercial demand can get there. Nevertheless, it's cool stuff. Alright, everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the newsletter, and I'll see you guys next time.